Now, if at this point in the discussion you understand completely what AF is, then fine, you can stop this video, move on to the next one. For those of you who might want some more practical explanations, let's go ahead and take a look at a practical example. And I'd also like the chance to convince those of you who don't have very, very large systems why this is still useful, even with a moderately sized PI system. Now let's just pretend that you've got a system in which you've got tanks, some kind of a production system, and there's an environment in which you have tanks. We've got a single tank called T115A. In the same facility, you also have a waste treatment area, and in waste treatment, there's also a tank. Now, so for both of these tanks, you're probably measuring in pi the level. So T115A is probably a pi tag that records the level of that tank. T117C may be a second tag that's measuring the level of this other tank. The guys over in waste treatment, however, have gone one step further, though. They have a calculation that's actually doing volume based on the level. And that ends up being, for them, a more useful value than level. So their convention is to call that CL. And it's not a particularly good convention. It's just their naming convention. Any calculation has a .cl at the end of it, and that's a pi tag name. Now, sooner or later, you all at your area, independent of what they're doing over here in waste treatment, over in your area, you say, hey, you know, it would be nice to have a calculation that calculates volume from this level, so let's go ahead and do that. Unfortunately, you went to a different school or whatever, and you don't have the same naming convention. You end up calling it CL T115A. Your convention is not to put the calculation indicator at the end, but at the beginning of the tag name. Now, that's a pretty bad example, but what we see all the time is different operating areas within the same overall PI system develop different conventions. Something as simple as whether it's a prefix or a suffix that indicates whether it's a calculation that you're looking at. So, believe me, it may not be this black and white with two tags, but when you're talking about 10,000 tags and thousands of calculations, it's very easy over the years for these kinds of inconsistencies to arise. So what about, you know, the poor new guy that comes in who is a yield accountant, or maybe he's a new plant manager? He wants to see on one display all the volumes that are done as calculations of these tanks. So now you have to go to them and say, well, I'm really sorry, we're kind of idiots here. We've come up with two different naming conventions and they're inconsistent. So here's a little chart. We've actually seen this. You know, customers come up with these charts that they hand out to all their users saying, okay, if you want to find this, this is the name. And they're kind of stuck with it because so many displays are built, so many reports have those names, they just don't feel like changing them. So that's how these kind of inconsistencies creep into a system over the years. Now let's give another example. Let's say the folks over in waste treatment, they have a calculation, so they use the CL suffix. This time it's going to be an alarm, so that, you know, say 30 minutes before a tank's going to hit 100%, they will go ahead and send out an email message. Great, you've got an alarm, it works well. Again, over in this area, we do the same thing, except we use a different convention. And these kinds of inconsistencies can creep into a system very slowly over time, so that what you end up with is something, I mean, basically you need to sit there with an Excel spreadsheet and a pivot table to try to figure out where all your assets are. And we've seen this happen over time. It's not something that happens immediately, it's just something that kind of happens to a system. Okay, so how can AF help prevent a situation like this? Okay, let's say you've got a brand new plant, or even if it's not a new plant, if it's a plant that has all these kinds of inconsistencies in there, what you can do, either if it's new or if it's a system that's been around for a while, you can start creating a structure that represents physically what your assets are. So for example, you've got a north end. Within north end, there's a tank farm. And within the tank farm, there's a tank called T115A. And then as you build this structure, you add all the other tanks, T115A, T117C, et cetera, plus any other tanks. You know, this was the original, this is the one in the waste treatment area. Now, as you're adding these things, you can also add these indicators or pointers to where you can find, for example, the calculation for the T115A or the alarm for T115A. And then if you need to find the calculation and the alarm in T117C, you can see that right here. Now, it doesn't matter if this points to some, you know, very poorly named tag that's got no naming convention whatsoever that any human can read. It doesn't matter. If you've got existing naming conventions that go back years and years, you don't even have to change those. These are just pointers that point, you know, where those assets can be found. Now, hopefully, if it's a brand new system, you'll come up with a good naming convention, you know, better than the one I just demonstrated. But as you can see, it really doesn't matter because, you know, as you add all these assets, these other tanks, all you're really doing is creating an overlay on top of your assets. You're building a model of all the assets, or what we've been calling an asset database, or this asset framework, AF. So the asset framework is simply a structure, an overlay. The developers are keen on calling it an abstraction layer. But whatever you call it, it's just this overlay that overlays your actual equipment that tries to give you better pointers or better directions to find those particular pieces of information. So that's how AF will help in this situation. It doesn't matter if you've got a good, bad naming convention. It always would be useful to be able to look those things up using something other than just the naming convention. And as you can see with the asset framework, that's what we're doing here. Now, one more thing AF can do. Let's say that, about midway through last year, you all decided to change your alarm. So instead of having an alarm that sends out a message 20 minutes before the tank's full, you want to send it out 40 minutes before the tank's full. Well, wouldn't it be nice if when you built that alarm, you built that alarm based on a template? And then when you made changes to that template, you only have to make that change in one place, and all the other alarms that are based on that template will get that update. Well, that's one of the benefits of AF and the template nature of building these assets. So as you can see, AF has added to the PI system because we saw there was a need for this. We wrote AF as a response to a need that we saw gradually over the years. People with these large systems, especially with these large systems, were just finding them unmanageable. And even with smaller systems, inconsistencies creep in. You know, we need a place to hang things on. That's one of the best descriptions I've heard of AF. There are all kinds of things associated with this tank that go beyond just the PI data. So we need a place to put those things, and that's what AF is for. Now I'd like to describe one more thing. It's not terribly important, but it helped me to understand some of the architecture of AF. What you're looking at here is a series of structures that were created in AF, and they're being stored by AF. They're being stored in SQL Server. As you saw in the installation, SQL Server is the kind of the storage media for what we do in AF. Although this data right here, this structural data, this asset data, leads to the PI data that we have stored for years and years. When I go to these tanks, I look at these tanks right here. Most of this is PI data. Some of it is calculations. Some of it can come from relational database, but most of it's PI data. Now, so what we're seeing really here is a structure that we create in AF that is stored in SQL Server that leads us or points us to data in the PI server. That's why you'll notice that AF and the SQL Server that's storing data in AF, it does not have to be installed on the same machine as the PI server. In fact, AF has very little communication with the PI server. You can think of AF as a kind of a map. AF simply points you to where that data is stored. The PI system is completely independent of AF. It's tightly tied to AF in that, you know, when you click on some of these attributes, that will take you there. But the PI server can stand completely independent, you know, of what's going on as far as this kind of routing or navigation goes. Yeah, the way I like to think about it is, you know, when you have a GPS that takes you to certain addresses, well, the GPS is not the restaurant you're trying to go to. Okay, just like AF is not the PI data that you're trying to look at. AF will take you to that PI data, but it's not the data itself. That's why they're stored in completely separate areas here. So in conclusion, we look at AF, it's a very important part of the PI platform, and it's a primary one that we're going to be using, we and our customers are going to be using for all types of application development.